Vitaly. So, welcome everybody. Welcome to this session. My name is Thomas, and today I want to tell you a little bit about how you can secure your Spring apps with KeyCloak. Before we start, a few words about myself. I work for a German company called Codecentric, and in my past life, I worked on the Spring data libraries that maybe some of you is using in the day-to-day lives. I really love open source. I work on a lot of open source projects. In my spare time, I organize the Java user group in Saarland in southwest Germany, where I live. And yeah, why can I tell you a little bit about KeyCloak? Well, the reason is simple. I've been a KeyCloak contributor for over 4 years now, and I contributed a lot of patches, fixes, new features, documentation, and examples over the past few years. And the experience I gained through this time is something that I want to share with you today. So, in order to dive deeper into what KeyCloak actually is, we have a small journey ahead of us, which will lead us first to the KeyCloak project itself. So we will learn what KeyCloak is and how it can be used. Then we will have an in-depth look at how the sing-a-sign-on mechanism that KeyCloak provides works and how it can be used by your applications. Then we will learn how you can secure your application written in Spring or maybe with other technologies with KeyCloak. And in the end, we will have a brief look at how KeyCloak can be used in the field. So, with having that said, let's begin with a KeyCloak overview. So maybe we'll start with a quick question. Who of you is already using KeyCloak? Quick show of hands. OK, a couple. That's great. For the others, you will see that it's a great piece of technology. And let's start. So this is the main website of KeyCloak that you would find under keycloak.org. KeyCloak itself describes itself as a open source identity and access management solution for modern applications and services. But don't get distracted by this title. It also works very well with existing or traditionally built applications. And you can also use it not only in the cloud, but also for your in-house applications. KeyCloak, what is it effectively? KeyCloak is more or less a Java-based authentication and authorization server. The project itself is quite old already. It started in 2013, but for many people and many developers I talked to, it wasn't on their map at that time. So it really started to get a broader adoption and became quite popular during 2015 and afterwards. KeyCloak itself is an Apache licensed open source project that's mainly built and developed by Red Hat developers. But there's a big community around the project nowadays that steadily provide new features, bug fixes, and documentation. The current version and the one that which I'm using for the talk today is 6.01, and you will see that they have a steady release cycle where they release a new version every 6 weeks or around that time frame. As said, KeyCloak is an open source project, but there is also a commercial offering available from Red Hat, which is called Red Hat SSO, which is basically the same product as the open source project, but with additional support and a more polished documentation. But it contains more or less the same. As said, KeyCloak has a vital community around the project, and there are now over 300 contributors contributing to the project, and with over nearly 2,000 forks, you can also see that there are many people trying out things and sometimes even contribute stuff back. And from experience, I can tell you that KeyCloak is a very robust system that provides you with a good documentation, especially nowadays, and you can find many, many examples online that helps you to get started quickly. But why is KeyCloak so interesting? What are the main features that it provides? Well, first and foremost, one of the most interesting features that comes with KeyCloak is sing-a-sign-on. Sing-a-sign-on, as you might probably know already from your cloud providers or cloud vendors, simply allows you to log in once to use many applications with just one login. The features that KickLook provides are built on a set of standard protocols like OAuth2, OpenID Connect, and XAML2, as we will see later how they are can be made use to integrate with existing applications. KickLook also provides a flexible authentication authorization mechanism that you can adapt to your needs, but already provides quite a bunch of features out of the box. For instance, it also comes with built-in multi-factor authentication, such that your users can secure their account by letting themselves register an additional two-factor authentication mechanism for their account. Additionally, they can also use other existing accounts and integrate with existing identity providers like Google, Facebook, Twitter, or cloud provider ones like Azure Active Directory, and similar mechanisms. That makes it easy to reuse accounts across many different applications. KickLook also provides a centralized user management that is functional, but basic, but gets the job done, as you will see. For integration with existing user bases, like think of an Active Directory or any LDAP-capable store, there is support for integration with directory services such that you can connect with your existing user base. And besides that, KickLook is highly customizable when it comes to look and feel, for instance, or some parameterizations with respect to the protocol interactions that KickLook offers. But even if that is not enough, it is also highly extensible such that you can teach KickLook new tricks by contributing your own code or running your own code for authentication, authorization, or in between. Besides that, you will also see that KickLook is quite easy to set up, at least on a developer machine, and if you follow some guidelines, also for production. It's not that hard, but it's not trivial, I have to say. And it makes it easy to integrate with existing applications because of it using some standardized protocols and provides some pre-built integrations that make it easy to secure your apps. Okay, before we dive too deep into KickLook itself, we have to get ourselves familiar with some of its core concepts. And one of the main structure in the KickLook environment is the so-called realm, which is some kind of centralized structuring element or some kind of container that hosts objects like your users, your applications that you want to secure, which are called clients, your authorization structures like roles, groups, and similar things, as well as general settings like UIs, themes, or parameterizations of some protocol interactions. Besides that, you have also structure components like identity provider configurations that provides you with the integration of a set of social logins or identity providers that are already pre-configured, where you only need to configure your access credentials and something like that, and boom, you have a Google login. And if this is not enough, you can also use a generic implementation based on OpenID Connect or SAML to connect with your potentially existing identity provider or your partner's identity provider, what have you. Besides that, KickLook also provides this user federation mechanism to integrate with existing user stores. As I said, you can connect to any LDAP store, be it Active Directory or Active Directory, Lightweight Directory Service, and similar things, or a Kerberos-based directory server. And as said, if this is not enough, this user federation mechanism is highly pluggable. So, for instance, you can write a user federation provider, so to speak, that can expose users from your proprietary user database to KickLook. Besides that, KickLook also provides some kind of key management. KickLook uses public-private cryptography to sign structures like JSON web tokens and, of course, offers clients to the possibility to verify the signatures. And therefore, there are the keys structures managed by the Realm also. Now, a quick differentiation between identity provider and user federation, because people often mix them up. identity provider effectively gives you the possibility to log in via an external authentication provider, so via an external login page, so to speak. And the user federation, on the other hand, uses the Keycloak login pages with the data from your internal user store, for instance, right? That's the difference. Here you have an external service, external login page. Here you have the Keycloak login page. That's for simple differentiation. Okay. With having the main concepts covered, let's dive into the admin console, which looks like that. Here, first, we have to log in, of course. Keycloak protects its own admin console with itself, which makes sense. This is the basic login page that you get by Keycloak. And if we log in, we see something like that. I hope you can see it in the back a little bit. As you can see, here I am, have the realm configuration in front of me. Currently, we are editing the Acme realm that I created for this demo. And for this, I can now adjust several settings. The first thing I want to show you is the thing that impressed me most when I started with Keycloak, which is the adaptability of the login page. For instance, who of you has already built a login page once in their lives, right? Probably all of you, right? Who of you had to implement stuff like forgot password, user registration, and remember me, right? Okay, some hands go up. Who liked the experience? Okay, not too many. That's the same for me. So now look at this. This is the plain login page that Keycloak provides, and just we are a matter of toggling some knobs here. I can customize the login page, wait a second, and boom, now I have working a user registration method and working forgot password mechanisms, right? With just a matter of toggling a few buttons. And this, when I saw this for the first time, it completely blew me away. Because I remember those days when I had to implement it myself and spent many weeks with my team to get this done, right? And this gets provided to you for almost no effort. Another nice thing is that you can customize the look and feel a bit, like you can customize how the login looks like and the account console that we will see in a bit. You could even customize the admin console if you like. And of course, Keycloak sends a bunch of emails. You can configure the look and feel there as well. But let's quickly change to another look and feel for the login page. I hope the resolution will not destroy it completely. Looks decent, right? With just a matter of toggling to a different theme, I can convey my corporate CI in a matter of seconds without having to do much anything else, right? Of course, I provided a theme in some way that is quite easy, and now I can log in as a user, and then I will see the user account management that Keycloak provides. Keycloak gives you, your users, the opportunity to manage their accounts themselves. So for instance, they can manage their profile, they can self-manage their passwords, they can reset passwords or change passwords here. They can register their own two-factor authentication by scanning their QR code and using applications like Google Authenticator, FreeOTP, and the like. And they of course have a list or an access to their applications which they are assigned to them. The thing is, this looks quite ugly, so to speak, or quite functional, as developers would say. The thing is, you can also completely customize that as well. So you can adjust it to your CI needs, and then you can imagine that you can already make use of it without changing much of its structure. Okay, that was the login, and so forth. You can adjust some other settings in the realm. But besides that, the most interesting thing is, of course, how you can secure your applications with this, right? And as said, applications in the sense of Keycloak are so-called clients. And you would register your web apps, mobile apps, or desktop apps as a client in Keycloak. And such a client configuration would look somehow like that. You would register, define a client, give it a unique client ID, and control what kind of login protocol is used for the client single-sign-on interactions, which could be single-sign-on or OpenID Connect. And then you can configure some protocol-specific protocol flow mechanisms and parameterizations. You configure a set of URLs that you are allowed to redirect to after login, and that's more or less it. After that, you would probably also configure client-specific roles, like, for instance, you probably have a user admin or something similar role for that are application-specific that you then can later assign to a user, either directly or via group memberships and something like that. And besides those roles on application or client level, you can, of course, also have roles on realm level, which are somehow global and could span across multiple applications. And the nice feature here is also that those roles can be hierarchical, or you can basically nest roles in other roles. Yeah? Just that you know, you can basically form a realm, global realm role user that includes user roles for some clients automatically. Okay. Then you can also configure the identity providers mechanisms, and I will just show you how it would look like on the login page. If I enable here a fake Google login and reload the login page, you would see something like that. You would get a button on the login page, and just with a single click, your users would be redirected to the Google login or automatically logged in if they are already signed into Google. Yeah. Besides that, you can also configure user federation, like connect to your existing LDAP directory and configure here that, for instance, you have an Active Directory and you connect, you say, okay, my users come from this particular path in my directory structure, and that's it. And boom, with just a single user federation configuration, all your existing users are already available to Keycloak. So now that we have seen what we can structure here, I will skip the authentication part for now. The most interesting thing here is of course our users. And this is the user management feature that Keycloak provides. So you can basically create new users here, or you can look at some users' details, like profile information. You can enable, disable, lock a user. You can also impersonate a user, which is quite handy in support situations. And you can, of course, control on a fine-grained level which user can import which other users. Besides that, Keycloak also supports to manage arbitrary attributes on user level, so such that you can assign a user metadata, simple key-value pairs. This is quite basic, but works. And of course, you can manage credentials of a user. You can set a new password, or you can trigger a password reset for a user, which will lead to the user receiving a reset password email. You can also manage groups. Roles for a user. You can assign roles to a user on realm level or on application-specific levels, like this here, right? So that just that you have seen that. Yeah. You also get some event information about what happened in the Keycloak system, like login-related events, login, logout, login errors, and so forth, but also admin events if someone changed something in the environment. As said, this is just a basic UI, but you can, of course, access this information and forward this to a more sophisticated logging environment like Elk Stack or Greylog and something like that. Right? So that's it. That's about it for the brief walkthrough to the admin console. So that's what we more or less just saw. Let's briefly talk about the technology stack that currently is used by Keycloak. So if you install Keycloak, you will see that what you effectively get is a Wildfly-based server. And the Keycloak application itself is nothing else than just a plain JAX-RS application that's implemented with REST Easy, so to speak. It uses Hibernate under the covers via JPA. And it also uses other JBoss-related technologies like InfiniSpan and JGroups to provide the horizontal scalability via distributed caches that distribute information like user sessions and so forth across multiple Keycloak nodes. For server-side templates, Keycloak uses the FreeMarker template engine to render the login pages and similar things. And for all things JSON-related, they use Jackson 2. And the rest is just plain JBoss technology stack. Why am I telling you this? Well, if you need to extend Keycloak in a way, then this is your stack. Of course, you can add your own libraries and own technologies to Keycloak as you like, but it is a little bit more involved to get it all work because of you have to use the JBoss module system, and you know, class loading is a thing, and you will see that quite quickly if you use that your custom libraries there. If you stick with that plain stack, you will see that it works out quite well. Okay, just briefly have a look at the server architecture after having talked about the technology. Well, a Keycloak server itself, or a Keycloak instance, if you would look at it closely, you would first and foremost see, okay, it provides some endpoints that are effectively exposing those related protocols like OpenID Connect and SAML. And there are some protocol mapper infrastructure in place, which allows you to map user information to the protocol-specific data structures and read them back to your users, such that the information that is stored in Keycloak can be exposed to other applications. Right? Besides that, you have infrastructure that provides the login page, of course, and the account pages that you saw beforehand. Is also available via a custom REST interface that you can use to build your own account management UI. Right? Besides that, for the real realm in Keycloak, there is a dedicated admin REST API exposed that allows you to actually manipulate a Keycloak realm via simple REST calls. So the admin console that you just saw also just uses all the REST endpoints. So everything that you can control via the admin console can be controlled via curl, effectively, right? For your convenience, there is also a Java-based client available, which is called Keycloak Admin Client, and just also uses this, which is just a JAX-RS client, which uses this admin REST API that allows you to programmatically create new users, assign roles or groups, and something like that. And of course, there's also for the DevOps guys, there's also a CLI that enables you to configure a Keycloak instance with a matter of a few commands. Of course, Keycloak also provides the before mentioned event infrastructure that allows you to forward events either in text form or in programmatic way via custom extension to any messaging mechanism that you like. Right, and you will see that in the demo later. And besides that, Keycloak comes, as said, with a bunch of integrations with existing user federation mechanisms or with identity brokering connectivity to several social login providers. But one Keycloak stays not alone, usually, not in production. So you can run a complete cluster of multiple Keycloak instances that are then connected via InfiniSpan and underlying J groups to replicate information like synchronous session data or realm configuration, such that the cluster can cope with one or more instances failing and so forth. So that is more or less the technical architecture of the underlying architecture of Keycloak. So after we covered that, let's briefly have a look how the Singerson actually works with Keycloak. And for that, we have to recap. Singerson asset means I want to log in once and then be able to access all my applications. Set, Keycloak provides a set of standardized protocols like OpenID Connect and SAML in order to provide you with that integration. And you should definitely remember that both possibilities work very well in practice. What Keycloak basically gives you is a kind of browser-based web SSO. But this doesn't necessarily mean that it only works for web applications. It also works for mobile apps and desktop apps. And I have many demos in my GitHub repository that I will show you later, where you can give it a try yourself. And it works very well, and yeah, it's quite useful. Besides the single-sign mechanism, Keycloak also provides support for single logout, such that you can log out from one application, and this logout is then propagated to other applications by Keycloak. Of course, those applications can opt out, so they can decide whether they want to react on the logout or not. Right? And one minor note here, never ever rely on a global lockout in a single sign-on environment, because there are many factors that can make it not work. Yeah? But it's there if you need it. So with that said, let's have a brief look at how the sign-on mechanism work. Here we have our user who wants to access this application one, which is protected by a keycloak. The keycloak server is, as you can see, on a different domain. And all those interactions that go through the user's browsers will go through this triangle. All other interactions that you will see are not through the user's browsers and are done via separate channels. So let's give it a try. So the user wants to access this application one and is not authenticated yet. Application one detects that and redirects the user to the keycloak instance for login. It does that by sending a browser redirect and passing its own URL as a redirect parameter to the browser. The browser follows the redirect and shows the login page. The user now enters his credentials to the login page and submits the form. And then keycloak can validate those credentials. And if everything's OK, keycloak will emit create a single sign-on session and will emit a cookie for the keycloak domain, like sso.ecme.io. Then keycloak will generate a random code and redirect, use the previously sent redirect URL to redirect the user back to the application one. But the application one still does not consider the user logged in. But it now receives the code that is associated with this single sign-on session on the keycloak side. So the app now performs a separate request via a different channel with that code and asks keycloak whether the code is associated with any single sign-on session. And if so, the keycloak will respond with a triplet of tokens, which will be the access token, the refresh token, and ID token for once. Then the app can verify whether those tokens are OK. We will learn how that works in a few steps. And if everything is fine, the app one can use this information from extract this information from the tokens and consider the user logged in. And now the user can use the application one as he wants to. So this is the basic flow that we just saw. And effectively, what you just saw was a variant of the OAuth2 authorization code flow for OpenID Connect. Right? Because OpenID Connect is built on OAuth2, as you might have probably learned from many sessions before. Okay, now that we are logged in, let's look more detailed into how those keycloak tokens actually work or what is in there. As said, those keycloak tokens are more or less OAuth or OpenID Connect tokens in the form of so-called signed self-contained JSON web token. Signed means the keycloak uses, as I said earlier, public-private key cryptography and uses its own private key to sign the JSON web token information that is sent to the client. And the client can then use this associated public key that is referenced by the token to verify the signature to ensure no one has tampered with this information. Self-contained here means that the data, the token itself, already contains data that I can use. The other variant would be a so-called reference token, which would just contain a UUID or something like that. And in order to get to the information that is behind that, you would need to do a separate call, which would introduce new additional latency and so forth. Therefore, keycloak decided to use self-contained tokens, or by-value tokens, so to speak, in order to spare this additional round trip. The metadata that is contained in those tokens are just simple key-value pairs that contain user information and potentially additional metadata, as you will see. And the tokens, of course, depending on the token, have a limited lifespan, and some of those tokens can be revoked such that they can't be reused after a time. And keycloak effectively allow, in the OpenID Connect world, essentially supports three types of tokens. One is the access token, which is usually short-lived in a matter of minutes. And this is the token type that is used to access applications, right? This goes over the wire all the time. Besides that, you have refresh tokens, which are much longer-lived in a matter of half an hour or multiple hours even, depending on the singer's own session length. And they are used to request new access tokens. So this is usually kept on the client and only exchanged between Keycloak and the client to retrieve new access tokens, which are then sent to all the other services, right? Then there is this special ID token, which contains the user information and is provided by the OpenID Connect specification. And then there is also a fourth type of token, which is so-called offline token, which is a special refresh token, so to speak, that is long-lived and valid usually for multiple days or even months, that can be used, for instance, for mobile applications or other applications that you want to authenticate just once in a while and then enable it to retrieve new access tokens over time, right? Yes, and speaking of those tokens, here are the JSON Web Token as an example, what is used currently by Keycloak. And most of you are probably already familiar with JSON Web Tokens, so I keep it brief. JSON Web Tokens usually are just plain strings that are composed of three components, a header, a payload, and a signature component, which are each base64 encoded and concatenated with a dot. And a word of warning, base64, of course, means only encoding and no encryption. So you always have to make sure that you transfer this information via a secure channel if you have some confidential data in there. Of course, Keycloak also uses those tokens, but in the Keycloak world, those tokens are a bit bigger than the usual tokens that you are used to. And I have an example token that I want to show you, such that you can see what's actually in there. And my resolution is killing me right now, but I hope I can do it. So you see, you have this three parts, the header, the payload, and the signature part here. And you see that there's quite a bunch of information encoded there. One thing is, for instance, the key ID, which is effectively a reference to the public-private key pair that was used to sign the token. And then that can be used to look on the client side to look up the actual code. Then you have the actual payload with some key value pairs here, which are the so-called claims, for which some of them are standardized. So they have a standardized meaning. And besides them, Keycloak also has a set of custom key value pairs, which Keycloak uses to transfer assigned role information, right? You see here, for instance, on realm level, I have a user role. And for this particular application here, I also have a user role, and here I have another role for another client, right? So that both information is encoded there. And of course, the user information is also there, like what is the display name of the user, what is the actual username of that user, and what is email, and so forth, right? So that's all in the token. That's why it's called self-contained or value token. Everything is in there already. Okay. That was the token part. Now move on. Now that we have such a token, how can we now use it to call a backend application? Well, I will show you just that. Here we again have our user who wants to access data from his app or wants to see his photos in his favorite photo rendering app. But those photos are not stored in the app itself, but in some kind of a backend, right? And when the user now wants to access this app, it just accesses this app via its browser, but the app itself now wants to load the data from the backend. And it does that by sending a request with the authorization header, where it uses the bearer, the JSON Web Token, the access token, as a bearer value to access the actual backend API. The backend API then, for instance, could see this request for the first time, right? So it knows nothing about Keycloak right now, or about the public key that was used could be used to verify this token. So it looks in the header of this access token and tries to look up the public key from Keycloak. Keycloak would then return the public key, and the backend could then use the public key to verify this token, and then extract the information out of it and use it to access the data of the user. And then in turn, could return the user data to the app, which could then display the information like the photos of my last vacation, right? So that's basically how it works. And I just want to make sure that even if your backend might be stateless or something like that, and just receives a JSON web token in the header, it still needs to talk to Keycloak from time to time if the token contains a reference to a new public key, because maybe the key was rotated on the Keycloak side, right? Okay, that's more or less it. Let's now see how we can integrate Keycloak in our applications. Well, for that, Keycloak provides some integration options for OpenID Connect in the form of so-called adapters. There are many pre-built integrations that Keycloak provides for the Java landscape, like for Spring Security, Spring Boot, a plain Servlet filter-based one for many Servlet containers and the like. But also, it provides it maintains a set of JavaScript-based integrations for Node.js or plain JavaScript or even Angular, AngularJS and the like, and even integrations for CLI apps or desktop apps. For OpenID Connect and for XAML, there's of course also a small variety of existing integrations which work also quite well in practice. Besides that, there's also the option of using reverse proxies in front of your application, so you don't necessarily need to integrate new libraries into your application to make it secure with Keycloak. You can also use projects like the Keycloak Gatekeeper, which is some kind of a dedicated out proxy, so to speak, which is written in Go, that would perform all this OAuth and OpenID Connect protocol interaction and would basically emit the authentication information or token information as headers to your downstream systems, which could be an easy way to integrate with existing applications where you can't change that much code. There are also integrations for web servers like Apache and Nginx for both OpenID Connect and XAML. But since Keycloak uses all those standards, you can also use plain OpenID Connect or XAML integrations as you wish. All work quite well, and I used a bunch of them already without using any Keycloak integration at all on the server side. So now let's come to the demo. Securing applications, what it means. In my demo environment, I have a set of four applications here, five applications actually, where I have this single-sign-on set up and a backend service where I can use access data from. So, for instance, if we start with the backend, which is started already, here I use Postman to access the backend API, and if I just send a request, you will see that I get a 401 unauthorized because I have not added a valid access token to my request. If I want to authenticate, I can do that like so. I can request a new access token. Ooh, no, I don't see it. And now I see the Keycloak login page here. I log in as my user, and I get back a set of tokens, which I then can add to my request headers. And if I now do a request, you see that I suddenly can access my backend API. And here I get back a list of to-dos, effectively, and here you see, okay, I need to buy milk for some reason. And the same data will also be accessed by another application. The other application is running here. And this is just a Spring MVC app, which uses a server-side integration of Keycloak. And if I try to log in, which I'm currently not, I see my backend application with the data from the REST service that you just saw via Postman, right? And in my application, I have links to several other applications which are protected by Keycloak. For instance, here a WebSocket chat-based application or a JavaScript-based app that allows me to see the contents of the access token that is provided to the application or the ID token and so forth, right? From the application here, I can also access my account where the user can quickly edit his profile or change something like that and go back to the application as well, right?
So, if I now log out in one application, I say log out, and you see that I immediately also am logged out by the other applications. And this is how the global logout works, or is propagated, so to speak. So, now, how it's done? Well, the backend application, there are many ways to integrate Keycloak in your application. The variant that I used here is using the Keycloak provided adapters, but in my repository I have also examples for using the plain OAuth2 or OpenID Connect support from old school Spring Security and the new version of Spring Security 5.2. So, what I do here for the backend, which is just a Spring Data REST application that serves this to-do endpoint, I define the Keycloak version, use a Keycloak-specific Keycloak Spring Boot starter that is referred to by this dependency bomb, and the rest is just a matter of a few lines of configuration. So just that you see that what the application actually is. This is just the main application. And here I have the Spring Data REST repository, right? Just nothing else, just a plain Spring Data REST app that serves me a list of to-dos in the sense of this to-do entity, right? And in order to make it work, I have to do some configuration in the application YAML, like I have to configure the realm that I want to use, in this case, ACME. I have to configure the out server URL where the adapter can find the Keycloak server. And resource is effectively an old name for client ID. And that's basically it. And then I need to configure some access constraints, like this URL paths can only be accessed with the role user or admin, or this can only be accessed by admins and the like. Right? You have such that you can manage everything on a centralized place. That's just one way to do it. There are many other ways, of course. The front-end integration, or my server-side front-end, so to speak, also uses this Keycloak integration with the, but this time I use the Keycloak Spring Boot starter as well. And here I use the Java-based configuration that hooks into the Spring Security infrastructure. In this case, I have a simple Java configuration class that extends Keycloak Web Security Configurer Adapter. And as you can see, I have here my traditional Spring Security setup configuration. And all those Spring Keycloak specific configuration values are then pulled through my application YAML again. So still, everything is configured here in Keycloak. And I had to work around some configuration problems here with this flag. I don't want to go into details, but nevertheless, you get all the information from Keycloak provided that you need to bootstrap your app. And in my example here, I have a simple to-do client that basically wraps a Keycloak REST template, which is a REST template that is automatically populated with the appropriate access tokens from the current user when making any remote calls. And I can just use that to call my to-do search endpoint, right? I have also some examples on GitHub where I use OpenFane and something like that, right? So that's basically how that works on the Spring side. The thing that I can show you briefly is how it would look with the new Spring Security integration. Spring Security, okay, Spring Boot package 2.2.0 M3 with Spring Security 5.2. All you would need to configure there is this. So I use this new resource server support where I just reference the issuer URI, and everything else will be derived from that URL by simply leveraging this standardized endpoint here, OpenID Connect configuration. If you click that link, which I contributed, by the way, you find all these nice configuration URLs at one point, right? And that's what they are querying underneath in order to derive those URLs. Okay. And besides that, it's just plain, where I have it, web security configuration, as you see. It's a little bit shorter than the other variant. It's like you just use OAuth 2 resource server, configure the JWT authentication, and then I need to some customizations, because the JSON web token contains these custom claims provided by Keycloak that you that I need to decode in order to emit the appropriate role information. Like, I need to effectively map the Keycloak provided roles. We'll quickly show that. The Keycloak provided roles into the, extract the Keycloak roles that are encoded in the JSON web token and encode it into a new Keycloak JSON web token authentication token. The thing is, what I just wanted to show you with this, you can use a create a Keycloak backend service or a REST service that is protected via Keycloak without using any Keycloak libraries, right? If you don't want to use that, it works perfectly fine with Spring Security OAuth 2 plain support. Okay, that's effectively it. You can find this stuff on my GitHub repository, Thomas Darimond, Keycloak Docker demo. There is everything in there. What do you want to know? Just look at this Keycloak demos folder, and there are many, many examples for different technologies, how you can leverage the current Keycloak integrations or the plain Spring Security integration, as you wish. Yeah. So I will give you the slides afterwards, so don't need to take a photo now. Let me see. So now let's wrap up with how Keycloak can be used in the field and how such a Keycloak environment could look like. Well, you can imagine you have some kind of bunch of applications that you want to secure with Keycloak, so you would basically probably form some kind of, have some kind of a reverse proxy that does some load balancing or web application firewall thing, and perhaps SSL termination and this stuff that would basically stand in front of your Keycloak cluster, and the Keycloak cluster itself would, as explained earlier, be use clustering via InfiniSpan based on J groups to distribute the data from the things on sessions between the various nodes. And what's also always important to have high visibility into what's going on into your system. So you would probably configure some kind of a logging forwarding mechanism that forwards some log information to log services like Greylog, Elastic, Elk Stack based environments, or something similar that gives you information about. That provides you with log monitoring or gives you the opportunity to react on alerts or gives you some dashboarding capabilities and the like. The data would probably come from a Postgres database, although Keycloak nowadays supports quite many different databases, MariaDB, MySQL, SQL Server, even the cloud-based versions work quite fine. And in order to let Keycloak talk with the outside world, it is also quite useful to have some kind of a custom event forwarding mechanism that basically forwards events that happened in Keycloak via JMS or Kafka to some kind of a message broker in order to convey some provisioning data like a user changed his profile or just logged in or just registered and the like. And this is something that I just want to show you quickly and then I'm almost done. Let me see. I have here my logging server, and I have here my. Okay, here we are. Oh, the resolution is really killing me. So, for instance, see here. Here I have Greylog. I hope you can see it somehow. The Greylog shows me information about what's happening in my system. So, if I just log in, I see the login information here with some structured log messages, like this was a login for the user tester that happened in the Acme realm, and there's some additional metadata about it. If I log out, I would get also the logout messages, which would give me a good measure if I analyze the log messages, how many users are logged in and how many users logged out, right? And this information can, of course, be visualized in a dashboard, something like that, where I can then see what's going on. Like, if I have users producing login errors, I would also see that in my dashboard, and this was an especially useful metric after I rolled out a new version, because then I knew when the login errors rate got too high that I probably need to roll back to a previous version because I did something wrong, right? it's always good to have this transparency in your system. So, and the next thing I wanted to show you, this was the dashboarding thing, logging thing, is transfer of this provisioning information. Here in this case, I use ActiveMQ that receives logging events, provisioning events via JMS, via a custom Keycloak extension, which is also available in this repository. So for instance, if a user changes his username or profile information, more or less, if I do a reload here, I see a JSON-based message that gives you the information, okay, there was a user profile update performed by the user itself. It could be also the admin user that does that for the user. And here is the snapshot of the current user profile information that is stored in Keycloak, right? And you can imagine you can add additional attributes to the user profile page such that user can, for instance, manage their addresses and stuff like that. And you can then give them the power to do self-service account management of that data as well, and propagate changes like address information changes to other downstream applications like accounting, billing, and so forth, right? And shipping. Okay, that's basically the environment. And with having that set, I can conclude with saying, unfortunately, I couldn't show you how you can start Keycloak, but you can believe me, it's just a matter of downloading the distribution from the Keycloak website, unzipping it, and you get immediately the same admin console structure on running on localhost as I showed you. Keycloak also provides some neat Docker images that are also pre-configured and good to get started, but I would not recommend to use the standard Keycloak Docker images for production, because they have a lot of stuff in there that you probably don't want in production. But besides that, I hope I could show you that Keycloak provides many features out of the box, like the single sign-on capabilities, social login, user federation, and the like, that makes it a useful tool to use if you have such a problem integrating apps with single sign-on. It also builds on proven and robust standards based on those standard protocols that we discussed. And yeah, it is very flexible. From my experience, I can tell you, there is almost so. It's hard to find something that really is not possible to integrate with Keycloak. So I did some crazy things there. You can't believe. You wouldn't believe. And at last, I can say that I think that Keycloak can be a pivotal part for modern identity management infrastructure and is a great tool that you should all have a look at if you don't use it already. So with that said, thank you very much. And sorry for the brief overtime, but I will remain here for questions, and thank you.